Hi everyone, welcome back. This is the second video of me creating a custom breakout board for the ESP32 DevKit V1 and others like it. Last time I made the power supply for the board, a battery jack for 12 volt power supply and a terminal block for anything else. This 7805 drop-in replacement buck converter turns that into a steady 5 volts for the ESP32. I also added two voltage probes that can read anything up to 36 volts. So let's get that off our to-do list. Today I am going to add two very capable driver pins for motors and relays and such. I tried to find the 3.3 volt and the ground pin. That is where the resistor divider will go. That will create me a reference voltage of 1.65 volts. Anything higher than that will be a logical high signal. I will test everything before soldering it to the board. Both resistors are about 100k. Excellent! The black wire is blocking some holes, making it a bit difficult to get the resistors in. But as soon as the resistor's leg is through the board, I can grab it with my pliers. I put the ESP back in the socket so that we can do a quick test. 12 volt adapter. On second thought, no, that's overkill. 5 volt from USB is more than enough to test. Just as expected. 1.6 volts. My vest is close to a 100% polyester. I can make arcs with it, like Raiden, but still haven't killed any electronics yet. Thanks again, autofocus, on my expensive camera. The IC is the MC34072. It has two op-amps in it. I'm still no fan of the soldering, so I will put it in the socket. Now, where will I put it? Let's make the socket stick to the board. We will only need to solder two pins to keep the socket in place. I start with getting the input voltage to the IC. And now some ground that we can get from the terminal blocks nearby. The solder is not adding up for some reason. But what's going on? Oh crap, it went to the other side. let's do some cleanup for future me. That's better. Does the IC now get power to the correct pins? Did you notice how the USB is outputting more than 6 volts? What's up with that? I just remembered. A viewer suggested marking the negative terminals to avoid mistakes. Thank you for that, kind stranger. Now I bring over the reference voltage to the negative inputs of both op-amps. This was a difficult soldering exercise, so I really need to check for shorts. No problem, sound. Great. My plan is to use pin 25 and 26 for my dual driver setup. Before I solder anything to them, I want to check if they actually work, because I hate desoldering. In the top right corner there should be a DUI for the ESP32. Shoot. What happened? Well, I had OBS in voiceover mode, so no video of the DUI. In short, the GUI allows me to toggle the pins over a web interface. Check the description for more info. So, the pins do what they are supposed to do. Let's do some soldering. I start with pin 26 because that one is the most accessible. Only now do I realize I have two wires on the bottom side of the board. It's not a real problem, but only for me. With the second wire, I realize I don't have access to pin 25 anymore. So I change it to pin 27, which is a gamble, because at this point I don't care about testing the pin first. Now that is all done, I need to check if the ESP's 3.3 volt signals are actually converted into the supply voltage, which is 5-ish volts because of the USB adapter. pin 26 does OK. And so does pin 27. Great. That is the circuit I am building. I have drawn the transistors and their pinouts in the orientation I am planning to use them. If I don't do this, it gets really confusing for me. And of course, I tested them. As I said before, I really don't like the soldering. Let's do this. To prevent mistakes, I orient the board to match the schematic. Being prepared like this, it will be a walk in the park, as they say. First, we place the transistors. Start with NPNs, followed by the PNPs. Let's put the legs of the emitters in the same hole for easy soldering. After soldering the emitters, the transistors can't fall off the board anymore. If we bend the transistors' bases for each pair towards each other, then we can drive both of them simultaneously. I need two 1 kilo-ohm resistors to connect op-amp's output signals to the bases of the transistors. The transistor pairs need a power supply and ground. Let's add those now. I will open up the web interface of my ESP32, so that I can toggle the pins by hand. That is really handy for testing stuff like this. And then I will check the soldered together emitter pairs to see if they follow the pin values of the ESP. Both pins set to low outputs, close to 0 volts. And both set to high, close to 5 volts. Excellent. And here we have the board driving a DC motor as a demonstration. Thank you for watching.